Hi guys, I'm not sure what's going on, but give me some hearts if you can see me, because I'm not even sure if this is going to my personal page or to my business page. So let me know if you're there. Had some technical difficulties this morning. Tried to start my Facebook Live and the camera on my computer wouldn't work. So technology is wonderful as long as it's working. And then there's complete panic as it's not working. So I am trying to look right now on my page and it looks like it's working. Phew, that had me a little panicked. Okay, give me a minute to get organized and we will get started this morning. Hope you guys are all having a good day. If you're in Canada, we have a long weekend coming up and they've released a lot of the restrictions. So dog training gets to start up again next week. I'm not sure if it's a good thing or a bad thing, but as a dog trainer, yeah, it's a great thing. As a COVID problem, not so sure, but we'll see and we'll go from there. Okay. Where are my notes for this morning so that I can make sure to stay on track? Here we go. Okay, so angle's a little different because you're on my iPad because I never got my computer working. Okay, so as always, please feel free to ask questions. And in the comments during the chat, I will figure out how to see those in a minute. And if not, I will answer them after the Facebook Live. And I do check back after if you're listening to the recording, and we'd be more than happy to answer your questions. Since last week I spoke about controlling the controllable, I felt this week I needed to talk about the other half of that equation, and it's the balance. Balance between control and freedom. If you control everything your dog does, your dog never gets to make choices. And those choices is what's going to give you a dog that understands what's expected, because what your response or what the environment's response to the choices is what reinforces them. So there are many factors that will help you decide how much either you want to give the dog. It's you're constantly changing your balance. It'll change because of the dog's age, because of the dog's temperament, your family. If you have little kids running around and a puppy, your puppy's freedom is going to be much more restricted than if you're two adults who have more ability to supervise the dog and less ability to make the dog go nutty like a little kid running around screaming. For me, having a puppy running around my house stresses me out. I realize for some people it's perfectly fine. For me, it makes me crazy. So my puppies don't get a pile of freedom, but I do always give them some freedom and ability to make choices. My very first dog was an Akita. For those of you who don't know, an Akita is a larger breed. They tend to make really easygoing puppies because they grow fast, so they spend a lot of time sleeping. We only used a crate. He was my very first dog as an adult. We only used a crate when we weren't home. And when we were home, Yukon had freedom of the house. He was a wonderful dog who really was just great. So we were lucky. He really only destroyed stuff. His house training was easy, easy peasy. Never had a problem. Had like 6 accidents in the house in the first year. But he ate a lot of stuff. He ate my brand new feather pillows. He ate my shoes. He ate his dog beds. At one point, he managed to pull a pair of pants from a bag full of clothes next to his crate. So he ate a pair of my pants. What I hated most of all was every time you got to relax, to read a book, to watch TV, to sit and have dinner, you spent the whole time going, where's the dog? If you weren't watching him, he was off getting into stuff. I hated that. That made my life not as pleasant as it was before the dog. And when you read the puppy list, you see a lot of that. Oh my God, I'm going nuts. This dog is driving me nuts. Let's face it. Now I'm busier with work. I have a child. The draws on my attention are much heavier than they were when I was 25 years old with my first dog. And that kind of supervision now would be impossible. It would just stress me out. So, and of course, costly and dangerous. If your dog ingests something that is dangerous for him, he could end up with obstruction surgery, which is easily $1,000. If your dog eats your brand new couch, it's going to cost you at least $1,000. I don't think I could come home and forgive a dog who's eaten my furniture. Every time I looked at the dog, I'd be like, but you ate my couch. So to prevent all of that negativity, I manage my dogs. Usually I use an X pen. With Wicca, that X pen is becoming a crate because she can't seem to not go to the bathroom in the X pen. But I've set this by giving them lots of off-leash exercise and ability to be a dog and run around. Sorry, I lost my place. And also lots of training, little tiny bits of training. Every time they go out to go to the bathroom, which is every hour or 2 hours, we spend 10, 15 minutes out going, let's go for a walk, let's do some training, name game, color grab game are the basics I start with puppies. But then we've got, right now I'm teaching her how to put on a halter. Her stays are being built. There's always a list of things to work on that you can spend little tiny time bites working on your dog, which is perfect. The other thing I do is puppies need a lot of socializing. I live in the country, so I make a point of every day or two taking her somewhere different. So she gets to see, smell, taste, unfortunately, different things. So when she's an adult dog and I want to take her into a downtown or something like that, she's like, yeah, been here, done that. The other part of this is that depending on your dog, you have to decide how much freedom you decide to give your dog depends on your family and your dog. We already talked about that. My goal is for my dogs to learn to settle in my house. For me, that means sleeping, chewing on a toy or bone, not pacing, not running around, calm. Remember, I started with Akitas. Akitas are naturally calm. Most of the giant breeds hang out. They don't constantly move. Now I have Border Collies. Their natural state is constantly moving. That makes me anxious. I want dogs, when I'm watching TV, I need the dogs to lie on their bed. They don't have to stay there like statues on a downstay, but they have to not be pacing around my living room. I've been in people's houses where their dogs are constantly moving. I find that just makes me anxious. So I want calm. My dogs earn their house freedom by how they behave. As they get older, I give them opportunities to hang out. For example, at first when they watch TV, they're usually on a leash. They learn that when I watch TV, they should hang out on their bed and chew their toy, like we just talked about. One day, once this is going really well and it's not something I even pay attention to, I'll let them into the living room when I sit to watch TV, not on a leash, and see what they do. I am still probably rewarding at the odd time, just throwing in a cookie now and again. I have kibble in a container on my end table, so it's really easy to reward the dog. Hey, you're lying there quietly, here you go. Or I might, I love commercial training. Means every time there's a commercial, you get up and you train an exercise with your dog. It keeps everybody happy. You're rewarding. Every time you pull your dog out to do an exercise and he was lying there quietly, you are rewarding lying there quietly. If your dog's jumping on your head and you want to do an exercise, now you're rewarding jumping on your head. And then it depends on how they do. If they do well and they mostly hang out, then I'll repeat it the next day. If they don't do well, then I won't. Then we'll go back to a couple of weeks of more restrictions and I'll slowly start to give them freedom again, and it's a test. I don't need them to stay in the same room with me. Most of my dogs do, but I've definitely had dogs that would rather, my young Border Collie likes to go to bed around 8, 8:30. He wants to go lie around 8 or 8:30, he wants to go lie in the bedroom. So that's perfectly fine, but it depends on the dog. Am I still worried he'll go to the bathroom in the house? Am I still worried he'll chew something? So with him, I have toys on top of a crate in the bedroom, and he would steal the toys. So then he'd lose access to the bedroom. Well, every couple of weeks, I'd open the bedroom door again and let him go lie on the bed, but if he stole a toy, he'd lose access. You know what? It took a couple of tries, and then he was like, okay, I don't touch those toys. I get on the bed. And now he's 5 years old, and every night around 8, 8:30, he goes to bed. My Chessie was a crazy puppy. From 2 to about 4 months, she was a whirling dervish. She was just like running around nonstop, completely biting. I would imagine she, like my current puppy, Wicca, she was very, very bitey. I would say her teeth were extremely uncomfortable. And like any child or adult for that matter, if you're uncomfortable, you're a bit evil. So once her teeth settled in, she was the best house dog with the least amount of work. She was at 5 months old, she earned full house freedom and never had to be crated or expend while we were home again. She also liked to sleep in, which was fascinating in a Chesapeake because, you know, their job is to get up at the crack of dawn and go hunting. But she was 9:30, 10 o'clock. She'd come out of the bedroom. She'd stretch. She'd go out, have a little play, then come in, lie on the couch. Perfect. My second Border Collie, Spec, who I've spoken about, he really never chewed. He honestly never chewed on anything. He was perfect. He was house trained easy. But he never understood the concept of settling. He would pace. It's like a nervous energy pacing. It's just, he would have this weird look on his face and he would just go walk around the house. It's constantly moving. Especially in a Border Collie, I didn't think that was a behavior I wanted to see. If you've got a high stressor type of dog, the motion keeps them in that state of high stress. And he is definitely that high-end type of dog. So with him, I wanted to take away that ability to move. As soon as you put him in his crate, he went to sleep. So I think he really needed to go to sleep, but just didn't know how to lie down and stay there. It took a couple of years that he would be crated in the afternoon for a couple hours so he could have a nap. Otherwise, he just did this weird PC thing. Now he's 5. It happens once in a while if something's going on, like my son's outside and he's inside. That will make him pace, but not like before. Usually he just lies down and goes to sleep, which is what I'm looking for with my dogs. So you got to remember with young dogs, behaviors kick in. And as they kick in, you have the chance before they become habits to stop these behaviors. For example, Spec with his pacing or barking, stuff like that. So this is where management comes in really handy. If you manage for a month, maybe 2 months, you can eliminate that behavior before it starts to kick in, before it starts to become a full habit. Some of these behaviors are self-rewarding, like I'm sure that pacing is. If I'd allowed it to happen, I might have never been able to get rid of it and then would have had to manage it the rest of his life. With Wicca, every day, my current Border Collie puppy, every day I am regularly adjusting her freedoms and controls as she changes and displays new behavior. Our latest challenge is house training. We started out like I do with every puppy. Every hour or so when they make noise in their pen, I take them out and give them a run in the front yard. They do their business and we go on with our lives. That worked for the first couple of weeks. She was perfect. She would make a little peep in her crate, not pee, peep. And then we'd take her outside and all was good. Then she wouldn't go to the bathroom. We'd walk and we'd walk and we'd walk. She wouldn't go to the bathroom. And then you'd come inside and she'd go to the bathroom. She also stopped making noise in her crate or in her X-Pen, which is telling me she was starting to go, yeah, this is what I do. This is where I go to the bathroom. So we had to start putting her up. At the same time, I was starting to make sure she could go to the bathroom on leash. I live in the country. My dogs have lots of freedom. I have to make a point of making sure my dogs understand to go to the bathroom on leash because otherwise it's really easy to always let them off leash. So at the same time, I was starting to go first thing in the morning. I'd put her on a leash, walk her out. She'd pee. Every dog is going to pee first thing in the morning. So it's an easy one. And she was a relatively steady, right afterwards she poops, so I'd keep her on leash, so she learned. So what I found was happening is, on leash, she was great. You'd take her out, she'd go to the bathroom. Off leash, she'd pick up a piece of mulch and run around, find a tree, find a sniff, look at the birds. We were getting more and more frustrated, and she was getting overtired, and we were sick of walking. So for now, she is on leash to go to the bathroom. And then if she's going to get a run. She gets the run afterwards. So she goes to the bathroom. I unclip the leash. I let her run around. The reward for going to the bathroom is getting to run around. I also reward her with kibble, but she doesn't really love the kibble. So it's not making a huge difference. I've also switched her from her X pen to her crate because she has yet, knock on wood, to go to the bathroom in her crate. So I want to make sure I have some place that she understands is not a toilet, because that is the first step of your dog understanding holding it. This is management. This is the balance of freedom. You just have to constantly adjust to what it is your dog needs and what you need. You might say, oh, I've allowed. So at first, I would put her on the ground and we would walk to the front door. Now, so I take her out of her crate, put her on the ground, and now we're on leash and walk into the front door. Otherwise, she's in every room, running around, grabbing stuff. If somebody's there visiting, which is fine, but when I need her to go to the bathroom, if she visits too long, then she ends up going. So she needs a lot of management right now. I know within a month or two, her management will go way down, and hopefully by that time, we start having some freedom. So much. I can't wait for a dog who's just being. I also do give her house freedom and outside freedom. Like I said, she gets to go off leash outside. In the house, it's a little more controlled. Usually I do one room at a time. The door is closed and I don't flip out if she grabs stuff or picks stuff up, depending what it is. I usually puppy proof the room somewhat before I let her go, and I let her just have around, check out the room. Maybe I'll sit there and just wait for her to go, hey, how are you? What I'm looking for is her to eventually get tired of the room and choose me. When she does, then we interact a little bit, maybe play a little tug, maybe have some recaller games, and then go ahead. So what I'm doing with this is giving her freedom and allowing her to choose to interact with me. What I see most of my puppy clients doing is, let's say the dog's not allowed in the living room yet because they're not trustworthy. Every time the dog goes in the living room, somebody's chasing the dog down, trying to grab it. So the dog learns in the living room, it's a free-for-all. I run around, I don't listen, I don't come when called. So that's what I don't want to happen. Or if you've got kids, or there's toys on the floor. I have a client who, the X-Pen is right where their son plays, which is perfect. The dog is learning to watch the son play. But the problem is, going to the bathroom, the dog has now learned, I come at it, which is like 10 feet from the door of their X pen to go outside. I come into the X pen and now it's a free for all. I grab a toy, you chase me, I grab a toy, you chase me. So the dog's learning keep away, grabbing the kids' toys, how to make you chase them, all these bad habits. So instead, now I have them, they put the dog on leash before they let him out of the X pen, and they reward him for going to the door, but the leash prevents them from making any other choice. So within a couple of weeks, they have a dog who comes out of the X-Pen, goes straight from the door to the door, ignoring all the son, their son's toys, which is what he needs to do as an adult. As an adult dog, I need the dog, or as a dog who has freedom, I need the dog not to feel that everything on the ground belongs to them. If you have a child, you have stuff on the ground. There's toys, there's socks, there's shirts, there's stuff. And your dog has to understand, this is mine and this is not mine. How they finally understand it, I have one dog that I'm 100% sure is using scent. So once a dog has it in his mouth, he considers it a dog toy. But if a dog hasn't had it in his mouth, he doesn't consider it a dog toy. I know this because I babysat a friend of mine's dog who would pick up my son's things but not chew them or damage them. He'd just carry them around. Once he picked up a toy, then my other dog would then start to chew on it. And my dog, Iggy, is destructive. So as long as he was destroying his own toys, which were mostly Kongs and bones and hard stuff that he couldn't wreck, it was fine. But as soon as he started getting into my son's stuffed animals, that was a big, huge problem. So it was really interesting to see. And then if I washed them, he wouldn't touch them again. I had another dog who, the only time he stole my son's stuffed animals was, interesting enough, stuffed animals that have traveled internationally. So, you know, we have family that travels, and when you have a young child, everybody brings you a stuffy. So he chewed the stuffy that came from China, the stuffy that came from Australia, the stuffy that came from South America. It was really interesting. I'm like, what smells would this have that makes you want to chew it? As soon as you wash them, again, wouldn't touch them. So each of my dogs have come up with different ideas of why they're not supposed to touch my son's toys, but they've all understood these are not available to you to chew on. So the goal of containment is controlling your puppy's or your dog's access to reinforcement. Hopefully, with my examples that I've given you today, you have a better idea of how much containment or management you have to give your dog for you to achieve the dog you want as an adult. What I always picture, what I go with my dog is, especially when my son was younger, is I want my son playing, my dog amusing himself, and I can make dinner without having to constantly watch and pay attention. To do that, I find the X-Pen worked great and allowed me to enjoy both my son and my puppy and not go crazy. I don't think my dog was loose. So I got a border collie when my son was a year and a half old. I don't think Iggy was loose with my son without immediate supervision, like me standing right there, until Iggy was about 6 months old. Other than that, it was supervised isolation, meaning I was rewarding Iggy for being on a bed, maybe on a leash, while my son played, or my son was napping and Iggy had house freedom, or Iggy was in an X-Pen and my son ran around. So what can you do to make your life with your dog easier and make you happier? Okay, so hopefully with this information I've given you today, that gives you some ideas, please feel free to ask questions. Don't forget to check out my Raising a Puppy in a Pandemic group. Lots of free information for you to work with. If you have any questions, let me know. Check out my website, www.dogtraining.ca. And I hope to see you again next week at our next Facebook Live next Friday at 10 a.m. Thanks, guys. Talk to you soon. Bye-bye.